This is WBSM On Demand.
It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. Good morning. Hope you had a great weekend. I did. We're coming into our best season here, right? You can really enjoy the outdoors. I think it's going to get up to around 70 degrees today. So enjoy it. That'll be fun. Then it'll be like 25 later in the week. So, you know, this is New England, right? It's May. It may be 60 degrees. It may be 70. It may be 50. You don't know. So, hope you had a wonderful weekend. We've added another business to our city, right? Surfside Creamery, they had a great opening. Great ice cream, hard and soft. So congratulations to Ian Abreu and his partners. Again, it's not easy to create businesses today in Biden's economy or in the city of New Bedford, but these gentlemen are doing it. And I think it's the best kind of business, right? Putting smiles on kids' faces and a couple inches on guys' waistlines. It's a great business. Surfside Creamery, down the south end of New Bedford. So congratulations to Ian Abreu and his partners. I think they're doing a really great thing. So if you saw the pictures on Facebook, check them out. They're on Facebook. Really, I saw Representative Tony Cabral down there enjoying an ice cream cone. And that's good, right? Politicians supporting local business. It's good. It's good stuff. So if you get a chance, go down and check out Seaside Creamery. Anyway, the town meeting went by in Fairhaven. Okay. Now, for those of you who aren't Fairhaven residents, or maybe you are and you don't even realize this, Fairhaven town meeting is a representative town meeting. So, in other communities around here, like I'll give Freetown as an example. Freetown is an open town meeting. If you're a registered voter, you can go to town meeting. In Fairhaven, you have to get elected to the town meeting. Now, that may lead to more informed government. Because in a perfect world, town meeting members get all the information they need. Well, legally, they're supposed to get it 7 days in advance. That doesn't always happen. Whereas in an open town meeting, you can get the stampede effect. In other words, people show up because they're concerned about one issue. They hang around and make uninformed decisions about all the other issues. And then right after their issue is heard, they leave. I can tell you that out in Freetown, that used to result in some pretty funny things. Not often. And before I was on the Board of Selectmen, but my father always went to town meeting. And he told me a couple of great stories, like, for instance, they voted on an education issue. Then all the teachers and the parents left to go home. And the old timers who've been there for years moved to reconsider the question and took the money back. When all the teachers had gone home and the parents, right? They woke up in the morning to find out the money was gone. In other words, That's, you can do it in open town meeting. When it's town meeting members, it's a more sophisticated audience, or at least it ought to be. So there are a lot of openings on town meeting. I would say this, if you own property in the town of Fairhaven and you're not a town meeting member, you are being reckless. Now, that's if you're qualified, right? In other words, if you own business, but you don't actually live in Fairhaven, then you're out of luck. But if you reside in Fairhaven and you're not part of the town meeting system, and, you know, look, for some people, it's beyond their capacity. They work too much. They don't have the time. I get it. Or they're too ill. But, like they have dialysis on Saturday morning, so they it would be impossible for them to be there. You know, people like that, you're excused. But for the rest of you, not only do you not have an excuse, but really, I think you're missing out on an incredible opportunity. People in New Bedford, people in Fall River would love to have the opportunity to go down and vote for their own budget. In essence, setting their own tax rate. So if you live in Fairhaven and you own property in Fairhaven, therefore you pay property taxes, you should be interested in being a meeting member of town meeting. And what I'm going to do, and I can hear the groans already, but really I'm going to use this forum to educate and encourage more people to become involved in town meeting. Now, that may be in Fairhaven or in Mattapoisin or in Freetown, Acushnet, Dartmouth, all of it. All of these towns, which are so crucial to South Coast, have property owners who are avoiding their civic duty. And I think it's because you don't know about it and you figure it's not my responsibility. And maybe it isn't. Maybe you don't want to take that responsibility. But others, I think, are just intimidated. Not it's not intentional, but you just go, I never really paid attention. I wouldn't know what to do. So I have to tell you something. I watched the pre-town meeting conducted by town moderator Mark Sylvia. I have to tell you, I was very impressed with Mark Sylvia, his presentation, his understanding, understanding that not everybody knows, some people it's your first time, I'm going to be gentle with you, that type of stuff. Really, I think he's missed his calling, and maybe it's for him in later life to be a college professor or a high school teacher, because he's an excellent instructor, excellent leader in that respect. So, again, if you haven't had an opportunity to see those videos, and if you're not a member of town meeting, I would encourage you to take a look, because there's still an opportunity to get involved with the town, to become a town meeting member here in Fairhaven. If you're at the meeting, I'd love to hear from you. 508-996-0500. It was ground zero for the vacant state representative seat here in Fairhaven. So for those of you who don't know, Bill Strauss, who served there for 30 years, has given up the opportunity to run again. Mark Sylvia is running up for the Democrat nomination. Oddly, he's not contested. Normally, there is a battle to be the Democrat nominee, while the Republicans generally field nobody. This time around, it's reversed. You have a competitive Republican primary for the state representative seat. That is Joe Pyers and Bob McConnell, both great guys. Bob is a town meeting member. He's the Republican state committee man for the whole region. That's the senatorial district. Joe Pars is on the Old Rochester School Committee. As I said, they're both good guys. They're both contesting for the Republican nomination. So, Saturday morning, you had, if you went to town meeting in Fairhaven, that means you're probably going to be voting in the September primaries and the November election, right? Why would you be a town meeting member and miss the presidential election? But if you were there, you were greeted by Joe Pars and his wife, handing out free coffee and donuts for people who were going to be at an all-day meeting. I mean, it really was a nice gesture. What a gentleman. Smart politics, what a gentleman. He knows about town meetings. They have them in Rochester. They have them in Mattapoisett. They have them in Marion. Have them in Acushnet. So Joe knows. And nothing better than sugar and caffeine, right? So to make a friend. So I thought that was really a great insight into Joe Pyre's mind. Recognize how to appeal to people. Because after all, if you're going to stop and shake someone's hand on their way into a meeting, the least you can do is compensate them for their time, right? So I thought that was a marvelous, genius stroke by the Pyres campaign. And again, Joe Pyres was out there. As everybody who knows Joe knows, he's got an engine, okay? He's private sector. He's an elected official already, won a very competitive election, beat a friend of mine for the school committee. So that was really an impressive display. Now, Bob McConnell, again, who's contesting for the Republican nomination, he was inside doing his civic duty, voting on the issues, paying attention, as was Mark Sylvia, conducting the whole meeting. He's the town moderator. Nothing happens at town meeting without Mark Sylvia being involved. So, again, I told you, I watched the video. I thought he was very impressive. He should be. I mean, he was a Deval Patrick appointee. Environmental stuff. He's involved in the private sector environmental business, solar energy. So, again, really a bounty of riches in the election for state representative, which is Rochester, Fairhaven, Mattapoisett, Marion. Part of Ward 1, part of Acushnet. So it's a really diverse district and a really diverse number of candidates. So bravo Fairhaven, bravo Acushnet, bravo Rochester. Competitive election on both sides. So this will be a barn burner all the way up till November. And remember, folks, this is about, happens to be those gentlemen seeking the election to the state representative. Nothing to do with Biden, nothing to do with Trump, nothing. If you think it does, you need a civics lesson. State representatives have nothing to do with the federal level, except that they're sometimes stuck with the federal problems that aren't dealt with on the federal level, like immigration. 508-996-0500. If you're at town meeting, I'd love to hear from you. Let's go to the phones. Good morning. Thanks for calling.
Good morning. How are you today, Chris?
I'm doing well, my friend. How are you?
I'm very good. You know, you're saying that you were fortunate enough to be at town meeting. I bought my first home in Fairhaven in 1985. Lived in the town for over 25 years. And there was one point of my living in Fairhaven that I realized, oh, if I want to go to town meeting, I need to be elected
for
that.
Yes, you do.
I found that quite strange. I tried a couple of times. The precinct that I was in was totally full, so I wasn't successful in that. And then I was fortunate enough to move to the town of Mattapoisett.
Okay.
And in the town of Mattapoisett, all I have to do is be a registered voter.
Yes, sir.
In order to participate in town hall. I think Fairhaven, the way it's structured now, is kind of like stacking the deck, I would call it. I'd like to see town of Fairhaven allow anyone who is a registered voter in Fairhaven participate in town meeting.
I would agree with you because that's how I grew up in Freetown. Anybody could go, and it does make it a little more volatile, but it does. It is more of a pure democracy. It's really the old-style New England town meeting. So I do agree with you, and that's. I will tell you that depending on what precinct you're in Fairhaven now, there's plenty of openings.
Right.
But you're in Mattapoisett except now.
Precinct one is full.
Is it?
It is. And you know, the if someone comes back with the argument, oh, we can't handle that many people going to town meeting, I guarantee you that if you changed it to that, you would get an increase, but it wouldn't be overwhelming because not everybody would take an interest in town meeting.
Totally agree with you. Totally agree with you. But you like it out in Mattapoisett. You can just go in. How often do you make it to town meeting now that you can have no restrictions?
Every time they have one.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
So you'd recommend that to Fairhaven. That would take an act of the legislature, but it's just a home rule petition. That is something I think should be explored.
I totally agree. Well, absolutely. You know, I agree because...
You suggested it.
That's my point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, and one thing about Mark Sylvia.
Yes.
I've known Mark Sylvia for a lot of years, and I think Fairhaven's very lucky to have him as the town moderator. But the area of for state representatives for that he would cover as a state representative would be that much more enriched if he were elected.
Well, I think a lot of people share that opinion, sir. That's what I'm finding out. And again, and thanks for the call and thanks for listening. I do appreciate it. 508-996-0400. Yeah, look, as I said, I thought Mark was impressive. That is not a low-stress job. Being moderator, not a low-stress job at all. 508-996-0400. Stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and that is, of course, Rush, a great band out of Canada. I have my problems with Canada, but they once confiscated my grandfather's rifles, along with bunch of other men from Fairhaven, for hunting illegally in the King's Forest. Took a congressman to get the rifles back. Hastings Keith got the rifles back for them. But anyway, and shotguns. So, 508-996-05. I don't hold it against Rush, though. I think they're anti-royalty. 508-996-05. But the town meeting defeated here in Fairhaven the accessory dwelling change to the zoning. That would have allowed in-law apartments, which are a solution for a lot of people. I think a lot of people, particularly younger people, who have older parents, but they want to keep them within arm's length, right? They don't want to put them in a nursing home. So they'd want to put an accessory dwelling on the home so that a caregiver can live there, or an accessory dwelling unit on their own home so that a senior citizen parent can move in. Right? I mean, it makes sense to me. So that was defeated. Why was it defeated? Well, because of the composition of town meeting, the majority of the people who were there didn't want it. That's really what it comes down to. I mean, it's a major change. I get it. I would say that parking is probably one of the issues that made people nervous. There are some neighborhoods in Fairhaven where you can see that because of the time at which the property was built, there were, you know, there are times when these some of these neighborhoods were laid out, the automobile, while it may have existed, was not prevalent, right? But may not have even existed. So there is some of that. And then the other thing is that people are resistant to change. I have no problem with that. I mean, if it's not broke, don't fix it. And I imagine that a lot of people look at it that way. 508-996-0. If you were there, if you voted on it, if you weren't there because you're not a member, but you had an opinion on it, maybe you shared it with your precinct representatives at town meeting. I'd love to hear from you. 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Hi, good morning, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. So this is Christina Lopes. I'm calling because I am a town meeting member, and I was there Saturday for a town meeting. The ADUs that you're discussing right now,
yes.
Fairhaven already accepts ADUs. This was just more of changing the type of ADUs that we accept between industrial areas and residential areas. So if you wanted to add an ADU, for instance, to an industrial building, town council clarified that, yes, if this was to pass, that you could add an ADU to one of those buildings.
Really? That's interesting.
Yeah. Yep. So Fairhaven does accept ADUs, and it was brought up during town meeting that they have never denied an ADU here in Fairhaven. In the past several years, they can't recall any time that they were denying them. But I just wanted to clarify that. Also, I wanted to add, I actually voted no for the ADUs only because there was no contingency that if a property owner had to or didn't have to live on the property. So say, for instance, somebody owned a home, had an ADU, moved out, more people would be more inept to buy these houses, like bigger banking companies and realtors that, you know, want to have multifamily homes.
Right.
So the resident wouldn't have to live on site, which is going to make the buyer's market more inapt to buy at that point, increasing the housing prices here in Fairhaven again.
Christina, that is a great point, because I can tell you, like, say in the Cushman Park area, there is not a parking problem, but for instance, a lot of people, you know, again, when the house was built, there was not two cars per family, you know, there was maybe one, maybe none. So there is a little bit, you know, there's parking on the street, there are people without driveways, and if you add an accessory dwelling unit or started to really see them add, that would add a parking crunch, which doesn't really exist now. How much of a factor do you think that was?
Well, I think that would definitely affect us as well. If more people would start, you know, packing the streets, that could be an issue. Normally, like if you're moving in, your in-laws or something, you know, generally as they start getting older, they move down to one vehicle as opposed to two vehicles.
Right.
So I don't really see that as a big deal, but you're right. In those constricted areas already, if we were adding renters per se, and they were younger families where you have two vehicles, sometimes three when you have teenagers with vehicles too, it makes it a little bit more dense and harder to navigate those streets.
And also, if you could add it, and I'm just going off what you told me, and I trust you, Christina, that they could, you could add an accessory dwelling unit, meaning a residential unit, to an industrial area, later on down the road, it's going to make it harder for those other businesses in that area to do business without, you know, when you have a neighbor there complaining. I can just see how it goes. So that's a very good, that was very smart. Again, these town meetings, people, things do come out.
Yeah, they definitely do. But I just didn't want anybody to, you know, feel discouraged or anything about ever applying for an ADU with the planning board, because Fairhaven already does accept it. It's just trying to add more from Mass General Law into it, and then adding a little bit more to give those industrialized areas more to it. So,
Christina, while, while I have you on the phone, I want to thank you, and I think on behalf of many of my listeners, for the great job you do running that Facebook page for the town of Fairhaven. I'm there every day, a couple times a day. Give your page a plug.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Chris.
What is it? What?
Oh, the page is Old Town Fairhaven, and you can find that on Facebook.
Old Town Fairhaven. It is must reading. She really keeps the town up to date on what's going on, and gives you an opportunity to comment on there, no matter how genius or inane the comment is, quite frankly. So, Christina, again, thanks. And thanks for calling and thanks for listening. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Have a good day, Chris.
You too. You too. 508-996-05. Old Town Fairhaven. I check it a couple times a day. It really, she does provide a great service to the town. 508-996-0, that's how you get on the air. Good morning, thanks for holding, you're live.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you're on the air.
Yes, I'd like to talk about the ADUs.
Sure, go ahead.
I totally understand where the cities and towns are against it, for the parking issues and all the other issues. But your state legislature has changed the general law and have defined what an accessory dwelling unit. And all those answers are in the definition. And it would be 900 square feet, half the floor area to principal building. You have to provide the off-street parking. You have to have the adequate area. You would have to have a number of different things. And it just seems like the cities and towns are starting to ignore it. And okay. What worries me now is with the MBTA communities, mm-hmm. It may be shoved down their throat if they do not really do this correctly. That's all I wanted to add.
No, I think that's an excellent point.
Everybody's ignoring the general law. And there were also all the cities and towns for years have been ignoring the case law for Ernie Bach. That just because I have an extra kitchen in my house doesn't mean I have an extra dwelling unit. Just because I have something in the lower floor of what's called the raised ranch doesn't mean I have an additional dwelling unit.
Hmm.
And the cities and towns have been running around for years saying, well, you can do this. You can rent it out. Well, no, you cannot.
Okay.
And if I do, now I'm breaking the law. So doing 80 miles an hour in my car, I'm breaking the law. In the parking lot, turning my car key doesn't necessarily mean I'm breaking the law yet, just because I'm capable of doing 80.
Well, that's a good point, right? That's an excellent point.
So that's all I wanted to add, that if the cities and towns are not careful, they're leaving themselves wide open. The only difference is you can't find an attorney that will fight a city or town.
thanks for the call, my friend. That's very true. I can remember this goes back to the 70s and the 80s. In Freetown, you had my neighbors, my parents, very good friends, and I was very good, the Garino family, wanted to put on an addition for one of the parents to come down and live there, and the neighbors were fighting it. Now, it had to do with the restrictive deeds, in the covenants in the deeds, but it was really, it became a nasty fight. And it was just, again, people who were professionals who had the money, who had an elderly parent, they would just want to put an addition on the house. They had plenty of land. I mean, really plenty of land. But anyway, it became a big deal. So I do recognize what that gentleman is saying is that if you don't conform to some degree, you leave yourself wide open to get it all jammed down your throat. We found that out in Freetown with a adult zoning district. We had passed a zoning package. There was no zoning in Freetown in the 90s until I got on the Board of Selectmen. Now, it had started before I got there. I'm just telling you, I was involved. But the package had mostly been done before I got elected by the other people that were there already. Anyway, we did not include adult zoning because it was going to be hard enough to get this zoning package passed to begin with without creating an area for nudie bars and pornography and things like that. But because we didn't have a little area, the whole town was zoned for it, if that makes sense. And someone took advantage of that. And they opened a strip club. Now, someone took advantage of the darkness and burned the place to the ground, so it never got open. But it was, for a brief moment in time, an issue in the town of Freetown. 508-996-05. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and I want to point you in the direction of Mac Auto Sales, 188 Rivet Street, New Bedford. They repair all makes and models. If you need to get your car ready for the summer, I want you to give Mac Auto Sales a call, 508-565-6221. They're open weekdays, 9 to 5. Now, if you have a foreign car, that's perfect. They specialize in servicing foreign automobiles. So I've told you, we bring Natalie's automobile to Mac Auto Sales. The way Natalie drives, we bring it there quite a bit. But anyway, ask about their aftermarket accessories and their quality used cars they have for sale. You can go by and take a look at their inventory. Now, if you're looking for something they don't have on the lot, go in and talk to them. Say, Chris McCarthy sent me down here. I'm looking for a quality used automobile. I need you to help me out. They'll be happy to do that. 508-996-05, so you can get on the program. Talking about all things Fairhaven, the town meeting. Of course, we know the situation with the chief of police is still very much up in the air. If you don't know what I'm talking about, go to WBSM.com, Google, in the search engine, check Fairhaven chief of police. Tim Weisberg has a story up there. We even include the recent legal decision by civil service that lays it all out. It's a very unflattering but truthful account of what has transpired here in Fairhaven. Now, I think the damages between the actual damages and the legal fees, the financial penalty that the taxpayers of Fairhaven will pay, is going to be enormous. Absolutely enormous. And I think that the damage that has been done to a really professional police department, very strong men and women, very strong leadership, is yet to be understood. In other words, depending on how the selectmen handle this, it could be smooth sailing for the next 25 years. Or it could be ship in the rocks, disaster, every man and woman for themselves, no lifeboats, not enough. Could be disaster. So it's really up to the current members of the Board of Selectmen, the select board, to figure this out. After all, we've lent them our power. They are our representatives. And there's another election coming up next year. Now, whether the incumbents will all run for re-election or step down, I don't know. We won't know yet. Will any of the people who ran previously? Remember, there were five candidates last time around for two seats. That means three of them didn't make it. I can't imagine that the desire to be on the Board of Selectmen has changed. It's probably even deeper now, having run and not quite make it, and having seen what's transpired, and recognizing that you may have the talents, one of you who didn't quite make it last time, to come back around and make another pitch to your fellow Fairhavenites, right? Your fellow taxpayers, that you want to join Romano and Saunders in making a new board. And that people out there need you. So I hope that everybody who ran last time will at least take a few minutes and consider thinking about running again here in Fairhaven. I hope that the decision is made as to how to handle the chief of police before that election. It seems pretty clear cut to me. But if it doesn't, then it'll be an issue. 508-996-0, if that's how you can get on the program. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and you are the audience. If you'd like to participate, you can at 508-996-0500. There was a really interesting editorial in the Boston Globe. I read the Boston Globe, so you don't have to, about our senator, Senator Mark Montigny, who represents, of course, Dartmouth, New Bedford, Fairhaven, Acushnet, and Mattapoisett, talking about equity theft. Now, of course, we have our disagreements with Senator Montigny. He's a very close friend of mine, but certainly I have my disagreements with him. And on this issue, there is no disagreement. This is about if you or I fall behind in our taxes and the city, and the city of New Bedford has done this, or the town, sells the lien, the tax lien, to a private developer or a law firm who then forecloses on you and sells your property. And they keep the difference. In other words, if your house is worth 200 grand, but you own, but they bought your tax lien of, say, $20,000 for $7,000. They sell the house for 200 grand. They keep the spread. It's a very lucrative business. But it also harkens back to the days of Robin Hood, right? Don't pay your taxes. We take everything. And as Senator Montigny, and we'll talk more about it in the next hour, but as Senator Montigny points out, most of these people have fallen into this situation because there's something wrong with them. In other words, and sympathetic, I could not be more sympathetic, right? They got sick and it made them unable to manage their affairs. And so then the municipality, which is of the taxpayers and for the taxpayers, then acts predatorial on those taxpayers. Now, look, people have to pay the taxes. I totally agree with that. And there are penalties for not paying your taxes. I agree with that. But we know this happened in New Bedford. Hugh Dunn, who, again, I know some of you have your disagreements with Hugh Dunn, primarily because he's not a great mixologist. In other words, he mixed Benadryl with Jameson's. You know, sue him. Actually, I think someone tried. Someone tried, but he won. Anyway, Hugh Dunn brought this up on the city council floor, got his city council colleagues to go along with it. Son Montigny had already been working on the issue at the state level, but it is just outrageous that, and again, I say the city of New Bedford has done this.